Touring Opera Company's quiz show, Riddle Me Opera. Our contestants tonight are both from Canada, so I'll be drinking Canadian whiskey. And because they are from Canada, they will be competing for the bragging rights of Canadian Riddle Me Opera champion. Plus, each one of tonight's contestants will receive a coveted Riddle Me Opera coffee mug. Don't spill that whiskey, Al. During the show, enjoy, share your comments on Facebook, but please do not share answers. And now I introduce our lovely host, Natalie Salins. Natalie.
Good evening. Welcome to Riddle Me Opera, the opera quiz show. I'm your host, Natalie Salins. Our panelists this week, Randy Garou, an opera-loving lawyer who once bought himself a guillotine, and Jessica Mamie, mezzo-soprano who has brought us exciting portrayals from bel canto to musical theater and is ready for more. Our guests this week are Marya Basaraba and Jay Stephenson. Marya, you have had a huge career as both opera singer and television star. Our stories last night were so incredible. I don't know where to begin or what to ask you. Marya is one of the very first women to actually be a co-host on an American game show, but she also has a fantastic story about how you once had to replace Sarah Brightman in a big event.
Yes, in fact, when you get round to introducing Jay, who's from the British Columbia area, Jay, you'll know GM Place in Vancouver. And it was the big arena, like the Staples Center in that part of the country. And the director of the Barcelona Olympics, the opening ceremonies, knew Sarah Brightman, and he wanted to be in, he wanted her to be involved in this big opening event that was going to feature Christy Yamaguchi, Kurt Browning, Shania Twain, all kinds of famous Canadian stars. And Sarah Brightman was to be the big star of the opening part of this program. Second part was David Foster and all of his artists, David Foster also being Canadian. Anyway, Sarah Brightman was very expensive. And it happened that a friend of mine was the conductor of the Vancouver Symphony that was going to be accompanying the whole event. And he said, I know a Canadian soprano down in LA, and she could handle all of this music just fine. They wanted to do a few Andrew Lloyd Webber things and end up with the finale of Turandot. So I went to the home of Peter Matz, who was one of the most famous arranger, composer arrangers in Hollywood, big Emmy award-winning, Grammy award-winning composer. I went to his house in Hollywood Hills and sang some music of the night for him and that sort of thing. So he calls the producers in Vancouver and says, oh yeah, she'll be great. So I negotiated a contract that was very nice for me, but would have been a pittance for Sarah Brightman. And it included first class air travel, a suite at the Sheraton, a bodyguard, a limousine, wow, all that kind of stuff. Oh, it was really fabulous. Anyway, I ended up singing in this program, started off with Music of the Night. And the opening strains, you know, so beautiful, started singing, and with about 10 bars, boom, screaming, standing ovation already for just opening my mouth. Dry ice, the whole bit. Then the next thing was 40 little boys coming out onto the stage holding candles, and we did, of course, the Pia Jesu from the Weber Requiem. Then comes the big Turandot finale. My bodyguard was a 6'5" film student carrying my lipstick, and he had this big cape for me, put this black cape on with white fur inside, and start wailing away on that very final scene of Turandot, screaming up on high D's at the end. And in front of me, they shoot off this massive wall of pyrotechnics that they hadn't practiced. So suddenly I'm getting sunburnt and blinded by this massive wall of fire, and out Christy Yamaguchi and Kurt Browning are skating in the front. And oh, it was so incredible. So the other people hadn't wanted to practice the bows, but I did. I was fine practicing bows. So the director actually put me in the middle of the bows. And the whole point of my final story is that I got a standing ovation and Shania Twain did not.
Oh, wow.
We're Shania.
And wow. After the event, the producer said, we have a little story for you. I don't even know if I should be telling this in a public forum, but here we go. It was a true story. So they said, you know, we were in negotiation with Sarah Brightman for the show, but we contracted with you. We were happy. It was great. Her people called and said, oh, David Foster's involved. We'd like her involved. She'll come for cheaper. And they said, no, we're happy with the Canadian soprano. They came back the next day and said, oh, David Foster's involved. We really like her to be on the show. She'll come for free. Uh-huh. And the producer said, no, we have a Canadian soprano. We're happy with that. This would be only in Canada, you understand.
Only. Oh, my goodness.
So they could easily have bought out my contract and had Sarah Brightman for free, but they didn't. And they said, come on back to the stadium anytime. You can sing for the hockey team and the whoever else. And so that's how that went.
Awesome. Great story. Great story.
Yeah. That's a good story. Yeah. Fun.
On to you, Jay. Try to top it.
The contest begins.
Yes. And the competition begins.
I don't have anything that amazing. Nothing close. I mean, I did sing at the Olympic Stadium in Montreal at a baseball game.
Amazing.
And that was awesome.
Yeah.
you walk out onto the in part. You know, a baseball.
Yeah. The infield.
And you see your face on a jumbotron and your face is like 40 feet wide. And you're just like, oh my God. And then you see your face go, oh my God. Like 1 second after you do that, and everybody's looking at you like, oh, you're an idiot. it was a lot of fun. It was for Father's Day and it was the Expos when they were still a team. And 30,000 people. It was just awesome. I felt like a rock star.
I did that too, Jay. And my family who were in the stands watching, they took a picture of me on the jumbotron and who's in front but one of the biggest fans of the Expos, Donald Sutherland.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Jay, you during COVID, you have written an opera, a musical opera, correct?
Yes. Well, it's more of a musical with an opera in it. The piece is called Camma Opera 1804. It's about Beethoven's collaboration with Emanuel Schikaneder, the librettist for Magic Flute. They wrote 10 minutes of music. The piece is called Vestis Feuer, the Vestal Flame. And the work never got performed. It's only 10 minutes, but it's got a beginning, middle, and an end. And technically it's an opera, 10 minute opera. And nobody knows about it. So I decided to write a musical around this 10 minutes. So I took some of Beethoven's songs. I have it arranged. I have like an arranger in Canada. And he took the music and he put to rock drums and guitar and bass and keyboards. And it's really fantastic. And I'm still working on the rewrites. It was supposed to go up in June, but COVID. So it's given me the opportunity to really hone it a little bit more. And I think it's gonna be very exciting if and when this whole thing passes, so.
That's amazing. Well, let's begin. So, in this first round of four questions, each correct answer is worth 1 point. With each successive round, the questions become more difficult and worth more points. At the end of the show, both competitors will win a priceless Riddle Me Opera rug, coffee mug, but only one will have the bragging rights as tonight's winner.
For all of Canada.
Right. That is correct.
Now, I think before we start, I'm going to have to open this that I bought last night. I'm not a drinker, but it is Crown Royal, Canadian Crown Royal. So I'm going to open it, and this is going to help me with my answers.
I brought my own liquid courage as well. Okay. I don't know if you can see that.
Nice.
It's
Gretzky wine.
Green Gretzky wine.
The Edmonton delegation.
So
from his own private vineyard.
You have fun with that.
Yes.
All right.
Okay, well, here we go, Jay. Here's to us Canucks.
Cheers.
There you go. Cheers. Okay, cheers. 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 Cheers, everybody.
I have
Canada.
Ruibus.
Yeah. Dad Allen.
If, okay. Coming back together. If you have answered correctly, you will hear Steph. And if you dare answer incorrectly, this sound will play.
Okay. I'm ready for some of those. Okay. You know, under pressure, I can't play Scrabble.
The questions in this round will be asked by our lovely panelist, Jessica Mamie. Jesse, the opening round is all yours.
All right, let's get this party started, everybody. This first question is for Marya. Here we go. It's a multiple choice question. In Offenbach's comic opera, Orpheus in the Underworld, what is the infernal gallop? Is it A, a racetrack, B, a dude ranch, C, a health club for the damned, or D, the music we usually refer to as the can-can?
Oh, well, I think I'm just going to have to say D, can-can. Woo-hoo!
You got it.
Thank you. That was a good one. I feel more confident.
Feeling warmed up? Feeling
like it's these are the easy right. questions.
Yeah,
right?
These are the easy ones.
Right? This is a cakewalk. You'll be fine.
We're going to move.
All right, Jay, next question goes to you. Another multiple choice. Bringing it up on screen. Okay. Who or what is the Flying Dutchman? Is it A, Sven Kramer, a Dutch aviator who claimed to have preceded the Wright brothers for the first successful manned flight? B, Thomason Vanderhoop, who piloted the first intercontinental flight of KLM Royal Dutch Airlines? C, Amsterdam resident Robert Jasper Grootveld, who in 1965 grew marijuana on top of his houseboat in support of legalization? Or D, a legendary ghost ship of condemned souls that can never make port, first recorded in 1790.
Oh gosh. I'm just gonna take a guess. D, a legendary ghost ship of condemned souls that
Good
can
guess.
Never make port. Wacht auf.
I bet there was some truth in every Bach. Other one, right? All the other little stories were real?
Yes. Sven Kramer was a gold medal Dutch speed skater in the 2010, 2014, and 2018 Olympics. So I'm really glad you didn't choose that one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so off we go to Maria's second question. Here we go. The Valkyries are immortal warrior maidens who collect fallen heroes on the battlefield and carry them to Valhalla. How many Valkyries are there? Is it A, 3, B, 9, C, 16, or D, as many as the load-bearing capacity of the stage will allow?
Oh, I'd love it to be D. And I know, I think I have a friend who's listening who knows exactly what this is. And I've seen it. I've seen something done with three of them, but I don't think it's three. Oh boy. I might get at that, but I think it's 9. Letter B.
Yeah.
Oh, good. I was guessing.
Good
honestly.
Process of elimination. It was going to be a 50-50 there based on your gut. So.
Oh, do we have that? Do we get that? Can we ask a friend?
Not yet.
No.
Okay.
We don't That's have right. Zoom capabilities yet.
Oh. Okay.
All right. And for our final question in this first round, we go to Jay. Bringing that up on screen. Hanging is relatively rare in opera. All the following characters face hanging. One is saved by a woman, one by three spirits, and one by a choir of angels. Who dies on the gallows? Is it A, Dick Johnson in The Girl of the Golden West, B, Papageno in The Magic Flute, C, Marguerite in Faust, or D, Billy Budd in Billy Budd?
Hmm. Well, I know it's not Papageno because I played Papageno. It's the three boys or Canavan that that save his sorry butt. Billy Budd, I can't remember. Margarita, she gets, I think God saves her, probably an angel. And what was the last one? It was
Dick Johnson.
Yeah, woman. You haven't considered A yet.
So we have Dick Johnson and Billy Budd. Well, there's no women in Billy Budd. So by process of elimination, I will have to say that Billy Budd goes to the gallows.
That logic, yes. I just want to commend you. That was some good like cross elimination there. I liked that a lot. Well done, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Canadian logic.
That was incredible. Stephanie, tell us our score.
The score is currently tied after the first round. Marya has 2 and Jay has 2.
Yay.
Thank
you.
Amazing.
There's another toast.
Mm-hmm. Cheers.
In this next round, each contestant will be given a short audio clip from an opera ballet from which must identify the opera for 1 point and another point to identify who is dancing or what is taking place. If you do not know an answer or give a wrong answer, in this round, your opponent will be given the opportunity to answer that question correctly for the point. Now, panelist rulings are final. All right, Randy, take it away.
Marya, here is your first tune. Maestro, would you play the ballet for Marya?
Well, okay, I certainly know the tune, but
I'm going to ask you two questions separately, and yeah. Jay will get a chance to answer each one separately. So, but the first one is, what opera is that music from?
I know the opera,
and I don't recognize it.
Well, I recognize the music, but I'm going to take a guess. Oh boy, because I was never involved in the ballet. I was probably making a costume change during those times. I know my opera friends are going to go, come on, you should be able to get this. Can I pass? Like, can I shift it over to
yeah, if you don't want to give a wrong answer.
Well, I don't want a wrong answer. I don't want to go, because it's so familiar, I'm thinking it might be, is it possibly from Traviata? I didn't want that sound. You made me guess.
All right, Jay, here's your chance to steal.
You know, when I first heard it, I mean, I was thinking, I think that's one of the dances in Carmen or something, but it's not.
Me too.
It's Verdi. I think it's Verdi. I'm guessing Trovatore. It sounds gypsy-ish.
Okay. Oh, good. I'm glad you didn't get it either.
Now, Marya, this is a two-part question. We're going to give you the answer to the first part, and then you have to guess. You have to give the correct answer to the second part.
Okay.
The opera, surprisingly, is Aida.
No, I sang Aida a couple of times.
I was going to say, I'm sure you've done the role.
Yes. But like I said, I'd be in a costume change while that's going on. Or meditating, or something.
And the question is, what is happening during this ballet?
Wow. Oh dear, I'm feeling really stupid. Let's see. It's not the Celestial March, of course, when they all come parading in. And it's not like Salome where somebody's trying to dance and entice somebody else. Oh dear. Do I have to guess? I have to say something. Do I lose my 2 points?
You can pass.
I feel really dumb about that.
But this is for the Canadian champion of Riddle Me Opera, so you might want to guess.
I might want to guess. Oh, well, okay. Oh, gosh. Yes. I'm trying to think of what, because it's very happy music. It's dancey music. So it's probably somebody entertaining somebody, right? Somebody being entertained. But they're all so miserable. I mean, everybody's miserable.
I have to get a guess.
For time?
I thought you said I could pass. Yeah.
I thought you said I could pass.
Of course.
Okay.
I gotta pass. Yeah.
Okay, Jay, it's off to you.
Okay. Well, I mean, obviously, this is not an. I saw the opera, but you know, it's kind of. Again, they're all really, really miserable. I mean, I'm thinking like it's Ramsay's Dance of the Seven Veils.
That's what I said.
You know. Can I pass?
Yeah, sure.
Terrible.
Okay, well, I would have never gotten this myself, but apparently the ones doing the dance are Egyptian dancing girls, and they're actually part of the triumphal parade celebrating Radame's victory over the Ethiopian army and the taking of treasure and slaves for the pharaoh.
I knew that.
Yeah, the Bengals.
Right on the tip of the tongue.
Did a version of that, I remember, yeah.
Right. Now it comes to me, although I was never on stage for that.
Sure. All right. Maybe I was. Move on to the second tune.
It was right there.
Do we get demerit points if we pass?
This is not Jeopardy. Okay.
Oh, good.
So, Jay, here is your tune. Maestro?
Easy.
Thank you, Maestro.
Okay, it's not Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairies. You know, it's funny because I mean, when I was listening, when I first started listening, I was like, gee, it sounds like Wagner. It sounds like Wagner.
It's not Wagner.
It's Humperdinck.
No, but it does sound like Wagner. Right?
Yeah, Humperdinck. It's Humperdinck and not Engelbert Humperdinck, the singer.
Right.
And it's from Hansel and Gretel.
That's good for 1 point. Okay. What's going on during that ballet?
I think this is the part where the little kids have been reanimated. They were like cookies before and they turn into like little kids.
Maybe in some stagings, I don't know.
Sorry.
Exactly right.
Okay, Maria, it's up to you.
Well, I'm kind of thinking it's in that big scene. Did you sing the father ever, Jay? Did you sing the father? Yeah, I sang the mother.
Just a couple years ago.
I sang the mother to Louis Lebhurst, actually, out at the Redlands Bowl for 6,000 people with a big orchestra. And it is very Wagnerian scoring.
Yeah.
That's true. I think it's at the very end when they're all getting together and the father comes out and they have this sort of redemption kind of thing going on. Yes, no.
Sorry.
Oh boy.
Ouch.
No, this Ouch. Is actually when Hansel and Gretel fall asleep in the woods and the 14 angels come out. And after Hansel and Gretel pray that the angels will be watching over them.
Oh.
And just as an aside, when I got married, we had for the walk-in music, we had picked 5 classical tunes, and that was one of the 5 for the walk-in.
Aww.
Beautiful.
So beautiful. So beautiful music.
It's gorgeous. Yeah. The music is beautiful. Gorgeous.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm feeling dumber and dumber.
That's a great movie.
Oh, great movie. Right.
I don't think you're going to have any problem with the next one. Based upon what you've already said. So the next song is again for Maria. Maria. And Maestro, would you play it?
Mm-hmm. could anything I've said up until now lead you to believe that I would know this?
Well, as I heard the music, I recognize that this is more difficult than I thought. But what I said before stands, and I can't say any more than that until you respond.
Oh, dear. Oh, umpatapatilvi. Well, again, it sounds very kind of lugubrious and Middle Eastern-y, sort of like Prince of Aladdin, you know, those guys. Is it possible out of Lakme?
Jay, it's to you. It's to you, Jay.
This is only a guess. I'm going to say Borod and Prince Igor.
Nice.
That's a good guess.
Easier than you think.
Actually, Marya, this is one that you actually named earlier in the show. It's the Dance of Salome and her Seven Veils before King Herod.
I don't know that opera. I just know that part of the story.
Yeah, we all know the video of the dance. We just don't know the music of the dance. So that was actually a tough one. That was a very tough one.
Now, yeah. Did you just give away what was going on? Do I get to say anything about
what's
going on? Yeah. Well, I'll tell you. Wasn't it? let's see. Who became quite famous? It's either Carol Neblett or Maria the mezzo, who was married to
Ewing.
The director. Yeah. Ewing, Maria Ewing.
Ewing.
Yes.
She did.
I think Ewing might have done it.
Au naturel.
I think so.
She did.
And then Carol Neblett was famous maybe for Thais taking her clothes off. Was quite amazing and astonishing and stunning, and they were worth looking at. So
okay.
A guy
who wants to
say
see
that.
Somebody who's not worth looking at. I could say that. Yeah. Right. I mean, it's all very sort of suggestive, but they're kind of disrobed underneath. So
my vote would be to give Marya the point.
I'll go with you on that, Randy. Yeah. I feel like the fact that she shared Salome earlier almost indicates it. So I'll go with it.
And she even did the dance a little bit.
I think that is very gracious.
I think that's very gracious too. Does that mean that Jay and I are still kind of even here? Thank you, Stephanie. Mm-hmm. Yes, and we're all having fun.
I feel like there was a lot of good effort put forward in trying to guess through, and we've kind of gotten over the fear of guessing. So I
need another shot. So here I go. You know, all right, funny. I'm not a drinker at all. Not at all. But for tonight, I feel like I need some little.
Careful,
little
be careful.
Yeah, have a good one there, Jay. Have a lot of that Gretzky 99, because this next one is coming to you. Well, our director will play it for you.
Like that confidence.
this is Richard Wagner again. So you want to know which opera it's from?
Which opera? Yes.
I think it's, is it Renzi? Renzi?
Renzi? Bum 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 bum. The famous trumpet solo we all learned in high school. No.
Don't say it.
Stephanie, is it Rienzi?
He played the sad sound.
Tannhauser.
No!
Oh, no.
Why did you ask me?
No, I was asking you to give the signal that it was
I was
going to
say
answer.
That. I was going to say a Tannhauser. I was going to say that.
Moving to the
Anheuser.
Next round.
I know. We're actually going to just move on to the next round. We're going to forget this question happened. Okay, everyone?
Okay.
Yeah, Natalie, that's a good suggestion.
Right? Wrong offer. All right, guys. Moving on to the next round. So, this next round,
there's a story behind that one, too. Mm-hmm.
is called and known as Who Said That? A famous operatic quote is read in English. Identifying who said it is worth 2 points. Describing the situation in which it is spoken or to whom it is spoken is worth another 2 points. If you need a clue, request the quote in the original language. Each answer would then only be worth 1 point. If you guess wrong in this round, your opponent is given the opportunity to answer and steal 1 point for each question addressed to them. Randy, first question for Marya, please.
All right, Marya. This is an Italian opera, and in English, the line is, "You vile damned courtiers, how much were you paid to steal my daughter?" What opera, who said that?
Is that Rigoletto? Okay.
Very good, very good.
Yes, yes.
And describe the situation in which he said that.
Well, I think that Gilda has been kidnapped, and is she in the sack yet? I mean, in the bag?
Well, to whom
in the sack connotates something else, but is she in the bag yet? And so there fellows.
To whom is it being spoken?
I can't remember the names of those guys. I know Sparta Fucilia is it Sparta Fucilia? No, that's another opera.
No, the same opera.
Oh, all right. Is it?
That's the same opera, but the wrong person.
Oh, the wrong person. Oh, then, you know, I don't know the name of Rosencrantz and Guildenstern or something.
Okay.
We'll
give you the 2 points for who said that. But in terms of who it was said to and what the context is, we're going to have to give Jay a try at it.
Oh, sure.
Okay, well, I know this one.
Yes.
Because I've sung the opera a number of times. Rigoletto is singing to Marullo and all the courtiers. Because his daughter Gilda has been kidnapped and is in a room on the side with the Duke.
Very good.
Good, Jess.
All right. Let's go on to our next one. And this is for you, Jay. So another opportunity for some points.
Opportunity.
Amazing. I love puns. So originally sung in French, shuffling cards won't change your fortune. The cards never lie.
Okay.
Who said that?
I'm going to have to say Carmencita.
That is correct. Well done. And now would you mind describing the situation? Who is she talking to?
She's with her two buddies, Mercedes and Fresquita. And they are trying to see the future in the cards.
Yes, amazing.
Yes, I think that is a fair answer. She is singing also reflectively to herself, but both of them are present and they are in that scene reading their fortunes. So well done.
Well done.
Opportunity. Well done. Opportunity knocks.
Yes. The card trio.
And what did the cards tell her?
L'amor.
Precarte. Oh, that's the wrong opera. Queen of Spades, never mind. I don't know.
Toujours l'amour. Right?
Yep.
Every time death.
All okay, right,
at least
Randy.
That's the one she keeps turning up.
So was that a legitimate question?
No. Was just
okay,
like
good.
Randy
asked. Thought he just threw the game.
It wasn't an illegitimate question. It's just one to get points for. Okay. This one is to you, Marya. This is from an Italian opera, and in English, it is, "Let us sing. The Lord is not dead. In splendor, he has opened the tomb. Let us sing to the risen Lord, who this day has entered the glory of heaven." Who said that?
Is that the chorus in Cavalleria? Oh, good. Yay.
That's great. And it's what that beautiful, is the situation?
Beautiful cantata. I sang this role. And when I sang this role, I thought, oh, there's my voice. Aha. That really works. Yeah. This is
one of the most beautiful choruses in opera.
Absolutely. Yes. It's really stunning. So Santuzza is very, very distraught because Turiddu is off with Lola and she's even gone and, you know, told on him to his mother. And this scene, the choir is singing this glorious cantata, and she has this massive solo in front of them, and she's basically singing about how upset she is. She's afraid she's going to be excommunicated, and she's not sure about her life, and it's very often staged that maybe she's pregnant, and that would have been the worst thing for a woman in a what might be a Sicilian village. Everybody who has lost a person in their life is wearing black, and so that's pretty much what's going on then.
Well, now the only thing you've described perfectly almost everything that's going on, except
almost
what is the purpose of those words that are sung and what are they sung about?
Oh, it's an Easter cantata.
That's it. It's an Easter cantata.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. Okay. Oh, okay.
Perfect.
Fabulous.
Okay.
Amazing.
I'm glad I got something. Oh boy.
Okay. So back to you, Jay. Here is another quote, originally sung in Italian. In English, this reads, I was her son before I loved you. Your pleading cannot stop me. Unhappy mother, I will save you or die with you. Who said that?
Oh my gosh. I was her son before I loved you. Your pleading cannot stop me. Unhappy mother, I will save you or die with you. Gosh. And so you want to know who's saying this?
Yeah, who said that? Yeah.
Okay. You can, I've narrowed it down to two.
You can ask for it in the original language as well, throwing that out there again.
But then I only get 1 point.
Correct.
I'll do the original language.
All right, here comes your clue in the original language. Era già figlio prima d'amarti, non può frenarmi il tuo martir, madre infelice, corro a salvarti, o teco almeno corro a morir.
Oh, I think this is from Trovatore. Manrico?
Yes!
Very good, very good.
I was actually, at first I was thinking what's her face, Lucrezia Borgia or something like that, but because there's a whole mother thing going on that.
How did the translation help you?
You know, it just sounds like one of Verdi's librettos. I knew it was between one or the other one. So yeah.
I actually knew that one. I did know that one, and have you sung in the Trovatore, Jay?
No, I mean I've looked at the music, and I have the score upstairs, but I've never sung Di Luna, not yet. But I sang both
Leonora first, and then Azucena. I remember asking,
oh, really?
Why do you want me to sing Azucena? He said, well, I love that lower and middle part of your voice. So I went to my teacher, who was Ella Lee at that time, and she was a specialist in the Verdi repertoire, had sung Trovatore as Leonora many, many times. And we looked at the score, and it was very interesting because all of the arias are in the middle voice, but with a pianissimo accompaniment from the orchestra, and all of the ensembles sit from F to B flat. And there is a high C interpolated into the duet with the tenor. So very few mezzos can even sing it.
Yeah.
So it's really one of those switchy parts. And I had a great time with that, with both actually. Loved singing Leonora and Azucena. So I knew that one.
Very, very cool.
Yeah.
So just to wrap up that question, you properly identified who's singing it. So now the question is, why is he singing it? Can you describe the situation?
He's with the, you know, like his camp, in his camp with his group, Alcagina, his, adopted mother? No, his mother. No, his adopted mother. Because she adopted him after they threw the other baby into the fire.
And it might help to also clarify, who is he speaking to?
His mother.
Don't say anything, Steph.
That's right. We have an opportunity now.
Opportunity.
Opportunity for Marya to explain and describe who is Manrico saying these words to and why.
Yes, I loved you before I knew you were my mother or something like that.
I was her son before I loved you. Your pleading cannot stop me. Unhappy mother, I will save you or die with you.
Oh, I just don't really remember that part. Azucena has been singing about, right from the beginning, she's crazy about a baby she threw in the fire, and she learns that it was, it was her, no, she thought it was her son. Oh, I honestly can't remember, so I forfeit that point.
Bum, bum, ba, bum.
Yeah.
Well, the situation is that Manrico is explaining to Leonora why he must leave her to rescue the gypsy.
Right, right.
To Leonora, yes. All right, guys, it is now time for our final round, our encore round, where each contestant gets two questions, each worth 3 points. Randy, please ask Marya her first question.
Okay, Marya. Several operas feature characters who sing songs they have written. For 3 points, which opera includes a young opera composer in the cast of characters? Is it A, Ariadne on Naxos by Richard Strauss? B, The Master Singers of Nuremberg by Wagner? C, The Impresario by Mozart? Or D, Theatrical Conventions and Inconveniences by Donizetti?
Oh boy, I really don't know this. And the only one of these operas that I sang was the Impresario. And I did it on a double bill with The Stoned Guest by P.D.Q. Bach. And the stoned guest was Rich Caparella. And he came in, Don Octave, Don Octave. And of course, it was meant to be drunk. So that destroyed my memory of anything that was going on in the Impresario. In the P.D.Q. Bach, I sang the off coloratura soprano Carmen Ghia.
Well, there's no steal in this round, in this on the first two questions, because they're multiple choice. So give it your best shot.
Okay. Well, there it says Meister Singers from Nuremberg, so maybe in that one. Okay.
No, it was the Strauss opera, Ariadne on Naxos.
Ariadne, I don't know Ariadne at all. No. Sorry.
Well, that makes two of us.
Although I did, I played a master class for a young student today, and the teacher was Deborah Voigt. And her big debut at the Met was Ariadne.
Oh, wow.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Well, if you wonder why I keep poking my ears, I have
Aria, so check it out.
Because the microphone I have is, I have to use a headset. So.
Okay, Jesse, off to you.
Thank you. All right, Jay, a multiple choice question for you. Here we go. Wine, women, and song are staples of life on and off the opera stage, but in some cases, inebriation is a ruse. For 3 points, which of these characters is not really under the influence? Is it A, Hoffman, who passes out after telling tales of his amorous adventures to a tavern full of students? B, Count Almaviva, who demands his regiment be billeted in Don Bartolo's house in the Barber of Seville. C, Madame Flora in The Medium, who is terrified to hear the voices of real ghosts during her phony seances. Or D, Nemorino, who grows so happy drinking wine that he's easily convinced it must be the elixir of love.
Well, you know, you have a contralto, Madame Flora. She's definitely a drinker. So she's drunk. I mean, if it's a contralto, she's drunk.
Hashtag stereotype.
The other three are tenors. And, you know, I mean, tenors generally don't have to be drunk to sing, but, you know, it probably helps. Especially if you're doing Hoffman or Nemorino. But I think the answer is B, Count Almaviva in Il Barbiere di Sfaviglia.
Yeah. Boom, baby. You got it.
Nice process of elimination.
All right, off to you, Randy.
All right, now the final two questions will involve a steal because they are not multiple choice. So be very careful on these. Okay, for you, Marya, the question is, when Japanese ports opened to Western commerce, visiting officers were provided a house, a cook, and a wife for the duration of their visit. A nice arrangement. In 1887, a French officer, Pierre Loti, published an account of his experience, which became familiar in Puccini's Madame Butterfly. Loti's ship visited many parts of the world. Which other opera set in India is based on his writings?
Well, I'm thinking it's that one that has the bell song in it. And I know I said Lakme before. I'm not sure if it's if that's the title of that opera. Is the bell song in Lakme? I know all about Madame Butterfly, but I don't really know anything about this opera reference. Oh boy. So
you guess.
Trust
my Oh well, that's helpful, thank you. So is it Lakme?
It's the Lick Me duet.
Right. Which I know very well, sing both parts, of course. Yeah.
The most beautiful duet in all of opera, probably.
There you go.
Oh, that's not the most beautiful. It's the one for the two men.
Pearl Fishers.
Oh, Pearl Fishers.
Well, that's Pearl Fishers. Well, that was the one that I was actually thinking was that it was Pearl Fishers. So I'm glad you encouraged me to go with my instinct. Because otherwise I was thinking about Pearl Fishers. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, here we go. Final question for Jay.
Final question.
All right. We've heard that there are a million ways to die in the West. In opera, there are at least that many. Popular exit strategies include stabbing, poisoning, and consumption. Other methods, such as beheading, occur less often. Who is beheaded by an axe?
Oh, by an axe. Oh my gosh. Well, it's not Les Dialogues des Carmélites. That's all the guillotine stuff. André Chénier, I think, is guillotine. They had their head chopped off. Oh.
This is a really hard one.
This is really hard. With an axe.
But it's a known opera. Sorry.
Oh, okay.
I
as opposed to an unknown Maria's opera.
It's a well-known opera.
It's opera. I gave Maria a hint. I'm going to answer.
It's not one of the Mozart comedies. It's not one of the Di Ponte arias, operas, is it? Okay. It's not Don Giovanni. No. Let me think.
And if no one gets it, I'm going to offer a clue if both contestants fail to get it.
I think your hint was what Natalie gave you, unfortunately. But I feel like that does make sure that it is not what we would maybe call obscure or way out there.
It's not obscure at all.
It's not a what?
It's not obscure at all.
Not obscure at all.
Yeah, it's a well-known one. Hmm. We did it at Casa.
Does the we mean that Jay was in it?
No.
I have to imagine that they did the ring cycle at Casa.
Really?
Yeah.
I think we give you maybe a 15-second countdown and give Mary Marya a chance to steal.
Les Huguenots, the Huguenots, I don't know.
Meyer beer.
I'm still proud of you for guessing, though, not wasting it. All right, Marya, a chance to steal. What do you got for us?
Oh, boy. Let's see. He had about 2 minutes. Do I have 2 minutes to think about it?
This is a steal.
Yeah, I know. Right.
Steal, exactly.
That's true. I've had time to think about it. It's true. You know, I'm honestly can't think of something where somebody got their head chopped off. Who got their head chopped off in a popular opera? I'm thinking Carmen, Butterfly, Traviata, La Boheme, Fanciulla.
Elixir of Love, no?
You've been in it.
Yeah.
I'm at this point, if nobody objects, I'm going to give a clue and let Jay, as the first contestant, be the first one to have a chance to re-guess with that clue.
Absolutely. Go for it.
Okay, Jay, it may help you to know that the character who is beheaded is not one who actually sings in the opera.
Good clue, Randy.
Doesn't sing in the opera. Not Buozzo Donati.
Wait, you can't get beheaded. Do the not things.
Is he even in the opera? Is he even seen? Or is he referred to?
The character, whether male or female, the character is seen, yes.
Hmm.
Oh. Actually, he does.
Maria Stuarta. Didn't she get her, head chopped off?
The character does sing.
Didn't she get her head chopped off with an axe?
The character sings, it was all that you hear.
The character sings a word.
Wow. And a popular opera gets her head chopped off.
Very popular opera.
Super popular. And just goes off.
Okay, here's your last clue. This will go to Jay. Gira la cote, gira, gira, gira la cote, gira, gira.
One more time.
Gira la cote, gira, gira, gira la cote, gira, 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 gira.
Oh, I think I know.
Hold on.
I know.
Okay.
I don't know.
I think I know.
Okay,
can
Marya,
I say now? It's my turn. Turandot.
Pardon?
Yes.
You got it.
I do have to step in though and say the level of clues in this was quite a bit, even for the difficulty. So I do think we need to not do 3 points on this episode.
Oh, how about one?
Panelist rulings are final. Steph,
now,
where are we for points?
So, did you guys make a decision?
Let's give two.
Okay, so Marya wins with 14.
Over.
And Jay has 12.
Okay, so either way, point, whether it was one or two,
exactly,
that would have been rough.
That I was going to be worried, but it was hers anyway.
Oh, that was so fun.
Congratulations. Thank
you. I'd be, you know what? How about if I share a point and we both have 13?
Oh,
let's
that's
do
very
that.
Sweet. I don't think it works that way.
That's such a Canadian thing to do.
I'm just not competitive, really, you know. I'm just having fun. It's wonderful. So what wouldn't that be? Okay, Jay, I give you a point. We're same. 13 points each.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So sweet.
Let's do that.
You
Let's
both
do that.
Played excellently.
Thank you.
So, I was gonna say that today's Riddle Me Opera winner is to the both of you. Congratulations.
Yeah.
You will be getting a priceless Riddle Me Opera coffee mug. Thank you so much to our panelists, always, Jessica Mamie and Randy Guru. To Elsie Harnsberger for the Riddle Me Opera theme music. To our writer, Phyllis Elliott. Editor Randy Guru for the audio clips, Robert Blake. And Stephanie Morgan Russell for scorekeeping, marketing, and social media. Alex McQuan and Donald Clinton, our technical advisors, and of course, Alan Medek for our executive producer. Special thanks to our sponsors, Cecilia Cloughley and Lampcraft, makers of the Gig Light Music Lights. This production is copyright protected, all rights reserved. Thank you mostly to our Zoom audience and Facebook watchers. I am your host, Natalie Salins. Keep listening, and we'll see you soon for another episode of Riddle Me Opera.
Dan, great Dan. Job, Natalie.
Yeah, thank you for
host.
Watching. Wonderful. Yes. Thank you for
thank
playing.
Thank you, everybody.
And thank you for watching Riddle Me Opera. If you enjoyed yourself, donate. You're a tax-deductible donation, a little too much Canadian whiskey there. We'll support opera targeting underserved communities around Los Angeles, and those performances will be admission-free. Any amount is appreciated. Simply go to riddlemeopera.com and follow the prompts. Your donation will make a difference. Check back for notice of the next episode of Riddle Me Opera. I'm Alan Maddox saying goodbye and thank
Alan,
you.
Alan, well. Just before you go, Alan, can yes, I have one yes. little question? One little yep. question. In which opera is whiskey referred to, and what kind of whiskey? Is it going to be Canadian Scottish whiskey or American Irish whiskey, and how do we know?
Oh, because, well, how they spell it is usually.
Exactly. And which opera? Which opera?
Which opera?
Butterfly.
Butterfly.
Exactly. Milk Punch
moon
or whiskey.
Moon of Mahogany.
Yes, and we know because. Mondo. Yes. Okay.
Thank you all.
Adios.
Kids. Would you like to pet my monkey?
What are you doing? Oh, and my cat is still there. I can't believe
yes.
it is still there. What's the cat doing? He's so funny.
He's so
you know what? He must have enjoyed what was going on because he never.